The following is a quote from Kurt Gödel, Collected Works, Volume 3, Unpublished Essays and Letters, edited by Solomon Pfefferman. Page 356. Quote, Is Mathematics Syntax of Language, 1953-1959, version 5. It is well known that Carnap has carried through, in great detail, the conception that mathematics is syntax or semantics of language. However, not enough attention has been paid to the fact that philosophical assertions, which form the original content and the chief interest of this conception, have by no means been proved thereby. Quite on the contrary, this, as well as any other possible execution of the syntactical scheme, rather tends to bring the falsehood of these assertions to light. I am speaking of the following assertions. 1. Mathematical intuition, for all scientifically relevant purposes, is particular for drawing the conclusions as to observable facts occurring in applied mathematics, can be replaced by conventions about the use of symbols and their application. 2. In contradistinction to the other sciences which describe certain objects and facts, there do not exist any mathematical objects or facts. Mathematical propositions, because they are nothing but consequences of conventions about the use of symbols, and, therefore, are compatible with all possible experiences, are void of content. 3. The conception of mathematics as a system of conventions makes the a priori validity of mathematics compatible with strict empiricism. For we know a priori without having to appeal to any a priori intuition that conventions about the use of symbols cannot be disproved by experience. The syntactical point of view as to the nature of mathematics doubtless has the merit of having pointed out the fundamental difference between mathematical and empirical truth. This difference, I think rightly, is placed in the fact that mathematical propositions, as opposed to empirical ones, are true in virtue of the concepts occurring in them. However, by adopting the nominalistic point of view and identifying concepts with symbols, the syntactic conception transforms mathematical truths into conventions, and eventually into nothingness. The expression thereof are the assertions 1, 2, and 3. It seems to me that these assertions for an adequate interpretation of terms occurring in them, such as content, disprove, replace, etc., turn out to be wrong. Moreover, I believe it can be shown directly that the arguments which may be adduced in favor of these assertions, including the existence of actual elaborations of the syntactical scheme, are all fallacious. The inadequacy of those meanings of the terms which make the assertions 1 through 3 true in particular appears in the circumstance that they oblige one to interpret objectively quite analogous situations differently. 1. As far as one is concerned, it is true that by applying certain rules about the use of symbols, to be more precise, about the truth or falsehood of propositions containing them, one arrives at the same sentences. Also, in the applications as by applying mathematical intuition. However, in order to have any reason for the expectation that in these rules are applied to verified laws of nature, for example, the primitive laws of elasticity theory, one will obtain empirically correct propositions, for example, about the carrying power of a bridge. One evidently must know certain facts, at least with probability, concerning the rules of syntax. For to expect this for perfectly arbitrary rules about the truth or falsehood of propositions clearly would be folly. What must be known is that the rules by themselves do not imply the truth or falsehood of any proposition expressing an empirical fact. Such rules may be called admissible. Admissibility for our mathematics entails consistency, for from an inconsistency all propositions, the empirical ones included, could be derived. But now it turns out that for proving the consistency of mathematics, an intuition of the same power is needed as for discerning the truth of the mathematical axioms, at least in some interpretation. In particular, the abstract mathematical concepts, such as infinite set, function, etc., cannot be proved consistent without again using abstract concepts, that is, such as are not merely ascertainable properties or relations of finite combinations of symbols. So while it was the primary purpose of the syntactical conception to justify the use of these problematic concepts by interpreting them syntactically, it turns out to be quite on the contrary. Abstract concepts are necessary in order to justify the syntactical rules as admissible or consistent. If mathematics could be interpreted in terms of conventions, which, for the proof of their admissibility, would require only the simplest kind of intuition referring to finite combinations of symbols, then the assertions 1, 2, 3 would be true. Although not completely, still to a very large extent, that is, prima facie content of mathematics would turn out for the most part to be an illusion. However, the fact is that, in whatever manner syntactical rules are formulated, the power and usefulness of the mathematics resulting is proportional to the power of the mathematical intuition necessary for their proof of admissibility. This phenomenon might be called the non-eliminability of the content of mathematics by the syntactic interpretation. This vicious circle, it is true, can be escaped by founding consistency on empirical induction. But at any rate, it is clear that mathematical intuition cannot be replaced by conventions, but only by conventions plus mathematical intuition, or by conventions plus an empirical knowledge involving, in a certain sense, an equivalent mathematical content. It is worth mentioning that the same result can be obtained without any reference to the applications. For, strictly speaking, conventions cannot even be made without a foregoing proof of their admissibility. Otherwise, the term convention would not be appropriate. So the use of mathematical intuition is replaced by 1, ascertaining the possibility of certain conventions, 2, making and using these conventions, hence the syntactical interpretation of mathematics does not relieve one of the necessity to acknowledge certain, by no means trivial, propositions of a mathematical character as true in the non-conventional sense. 2. The falsehood of assertion 1 points up the existence of a content of mathematics, that is, of mathematical facts. For if the prima facie content of mathematics were nothing but a false appearance, it would have to be possible to build up mathematics satisfactorily without making use of this pseudo-content. Still more clearly, the falsehood of assertion 2 appears from the following arguments. 1. Conventions about the use of symbols are void of content only in a relative sense, namely insofar as they add nothing to the theory, which implies their admissibility. If, for example, on the ground of the empirically known associativity of some physical operation, a convention about the dropping of brackets is introduced, then from this convention the associativity of the operation in question, that is, an empirical proposition, follows. If some convention about the use of a mathematical symbol is introduced on the basis of its consistency, the situation is quite similar. For, in general, such a convention implies, although not its own consistency, still certain only slightly weaker propositions, that is, substantially the same facts as those which justified its introduction. Generally speaking, any law of nature can be interpreted to be a convention, whose admissibility derives from this law of nature. It may be objected that in order to derive the empirically verifiable fact of consistency, which is concerned with the handling of symbols, the mathematical axioms by themselves are not sufficient, nor therefore the convention X in question. The answer is that nobody will call a law of nature, for example, the primitive law of electrostatics, void of content, because it has verifiable consequences only in conjunction with other independently known laws, such as those regarding physical space and mechanics. It may secondly be objected that the statement of consistency is for that reason void of content, because, unlike in a law of nature, all single instances concerning individual proof figures, which is all that is observable, can be derived from the axioms already before the convention X has been made. The answer is that the process of formal derivation in a theory is itself a kind of observation. So the objection is about the same as if it were said that a law of nature is void of content, because the single instance of it can be ascertained without its help, namely by direct observation. 2. The fact that the syntactical program can be carried through, in the sense of assertion 1 above, is due solely to these two circumstances. I. The true mathematical propositions follow from a comparatively small number of primitive ones. I. They are, in a sense, separable from the other propositions, because no syntactical empirical propositions follow from them. Therefore, if we had a physical sense whose objects were of a similar regularity, and similarly separated from those of the other senses, we can interpret also the propositions based on impressions of this sense to be syntactical conventions without the content, and associate no facts or objects with them or their constituents. The similarity between mathematical intuition and a physical sense is very striking. It is arbitrary to consider this is red, an immediate datum, but not so to consider that the proposition expressing modus ponens, or complete induction, were perhaps some simpler propositions from which the latter follows. For the difference, as far as it is relevant here, consists solely in the fact that it is the first case, a relationship between a concept and a particular object is perceived, while in the second case it is a relationship between concepts. Moreover, there do exist a great number of independent impressions, also of mathematical intuition, although for practical purposes, in the present state of science, a few are sufficient. One might say that, in contradistinction to other sciences, the experiences of mathematical intuition are not the object of mathematics, and that for this reason, the assertion quoted in footnote ? Is true. However, in truth, experiences are not the object of most other sciences either. For example, animals seen in hallucinations are not objects of zoology. On the other hand, a general mathematical theorem, in a sense, has the mathematical experiences relating to the special cases as its object. Hence, again, there is no substantial difference between mathematics and other sciences. 3. Even if mathematics is interpreted syntactically, this makes it not a bit more conventional, in the sense of arbitrary, than other sciences. For the rules for the use of a symbol, according to the syntactical conception, are a definition of its meaning, so that different rules simply introduce different concepts. But the choice of the concepts is arbitrary also in other sciences. Everything else, however, namely, what can be asserted on the basis of the definitions, is exactly as objectively determined in mathematics as in other sciences. Viewed from this angle, the content of mathematics appears in the fact that definitions implicitly assert the existence of the object defined. In particular, if a symbol is introduced by stating rules as to which sentences containing it are true, then from these rules, much of the same conclusions can be drawn, as could be from the assumption of the existence of an object satisfying those rules. Only in special cases, such as explicit definitions, is the consistency of such an assumption trivial. 4. If it is argued that mathematical propositions have no content because, by themselves, they imply nothing about experiences, the answer is that the same is true of laws of nature. For laws of nature without mathematics or logic imply as little about experiences as mathematics without laws of nature. That mathematics, at least in most applications, does add something to the content of the laws of nature is best seen from examples where one has very simple laws about certain elements. For example, those about the reactions of electronic tubes. Here, mathematics clearly adds to the general laws as to how systems of tubes connected in certain manner will react. That the latter laws are not contained in the former is seen from the following fact. A. The latter laws may contain concepts not definable in terms of those occurring in the former. For example, the concept of a combination of any finite number of elements. B. In order to understand the laws of nature, it is sufficient, as far as mathematical concepts occurring are concerned, to know rules which decide on their applying or not applying in each particular case. But such rules by no means imply the general laws governing them. C. These general laws may even require new empirical inductions, namely, in the case the mathematical problem in question should be unsolvable. For example, this may occur in a case like Goldbach's conjecture, which evidently implies a certain law about the reactions of a computing machine. Note that the general mathematical laws may even be required for predicting the result of a single observation. For example, in case the latter depends on an infinity, for example, a continuum of physical elements. Therefore, for a certain kind of physical theory, a new mathematical axiom which would solve problems of mathematical physics formerly undecidable may lead to new empirically verifiable consequences, exactly as a new law of nature. Mathematical propositions, it is true, do not express physical properties of the structures concerned, but rather properties of the concepts in which we describe those structures. But this only shows that the properties of those concepts are something quite as objective and independent of our choice as physical properties of matter. This is not surprising, since concepts are composed of primitive ones, which, as well as their properties, we can create as little as the primitive constituents of matter and their properties. However, in spite of the objective character of conceptual truth, it is quite necessary to distinguish sharply these two kinds of content, and facts as factual and conceptual. What Carnap calls content really is factual content. 5. Even disregarding the possibility that a mathematical axiom may be disproved by wrong empirical consequences derived from it in conjunction with well-verified laws of nature, it is in any event disprovable by an inconsistency derived from it. If an inconsistency is not recognized as a disproval, but only as a proof for the inexpediency of the convention in question, the same can be done for laws of nature, which also can be interpreted to be conventions which become inexpedient, in case a counterexample is met with. Note that an inconsistent mathematical axiom would imply also wrong empirical propositions, and therefore, before the inconsistency is discovered, would work out in the applications exactly as a wrong law of nature. If the possibility of a disproval of mathematical axioms frequently is disregarded, this is due solely to the convincing power of mathematical intuition. But it is the very starting point for the syntactical conception to reject medical intuition. From the disprovability of mathematical axioms, it follows that, if mathematics is dealt with from the positivistic point of view without prejudice, some immanent existence should be attributed to the objects of a correct mathematics, in contradistinction to those of an inconsistent one, exactly as is done for the objects of correct physics. Those objects, for example, infinite sets or properties of properties, are of a specific nature, that is, different from those of other sciences. Note that these mathematical objects and facts cannot be eliminated as, for example, infinite points in geometry can, since there always remain primitive mathematical terms and axioms about them, either in the scientific language or the meta-language, where axiom here means a proposition assumed on the ground of its intuitive evidence, or because of its success in the applications. Positivists, least of all, have any reason to attribute to the mathematical objects, in contradistinction to others, only some pseudo-existence, for the difference between the two primarily lies in their different intuitive character. While the role they play in the formalism of science is very similar, at least in comparison to the more abstract physical laws, such as fields of force, atoms, etc. Therefore, the attitude positivists should take on the basis of their own point of view would be to consider the assumptions of mathematical objects and axioms to be irreducible hypotheses of science, exactly as the assumption of a field and of the laws governing it. 3. As to assertion 3, it suffices to say that the non-admissible syntactical rules lead to empirical consequences and, therefore, can be disproved by experience. On the other hand, an a priori certainty that the syntactical rules replacing mathematics are admissible, hence a fortiori consistent, can only be obtained by extensive use of mathematical intuition. What psychologically plays a large part in whatever plausibility the thesis of the voidness of content of mathematical propositions may have, and what moreover constitutes the grain of truth contained in the syntactical conception of mathematics, are these circumstances. 1. There is no possible state of affairs which is excluded by a logically true proposition. While the content of a proposition seems to consist in the very fact that it excludes certain possibilities. 2. The logical concepts, in their use in empirical propositions, don't seem to belong to the subject matter of the proposition, but rather seem to be means of expression. However, if a proposition is true already due to properties of the means of expression, it cannot say something about the subject matter, but neither about the means of expression, or they would not be means of expression, but subject matter. 3. The meaning of sentences is defined by semantical rules, which determine under which circumstances a given sentence can be asserted. These rules, in certain limiting cases, may have the consequence that a sentence can be asserted under all circumstances. For example, it will rain or it will not rain tomorrow. Such sentences are true, but void of content. The negation of such sentences are excluded as incorrect already, on the basis of their structure, irrespective of any meaning, exactly as sentences which do not conform to the rules of grammar. So that logic can be regarded as part of syntax. However, as to item 1, it can be answered that there are different levels of possibility, as appears already in the distinction between physical and logical possibility. Item 2, even if the antecedent is admitted, does not exclude the logical concepts may be made the subject matter of non-empirical propositions. Moreover, what is regarded as the content of a proposition largely is the question of what one is interested in. For example, one may very well say that the proposition mentioned above, although it is nothing about rain, does express a property of not and or.